Good morning. It is a beautiful, semi-beautiful, it's changed already. It's a beautiful day anyway, because this is the day that the Lord has made. It is good to be in the house of the Lord, ready to worship and praise Him. We're going to bless the Lord this morning. I keep coming back to Psalm 103, you know, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. And forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, and who redeems you from your life of destruction. And this is the part that I absolutely love. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, and that your youth is renewed like the eagles. How many of you need your youth renewed like the eagles this morning? How many of you want to be crowned with loving kindness and tender mercies this morning? So as we worship, we're going to praise Him this morning and remember that on your head is loving kindness and tender mercies, and allow Him to renew your strength as He ministers and as we minister to Him this morning. Take it away, Sam.
Mercy, you're my help in time of need. Believe you are the way, the truth. I believe Find me dreaming. Find Thank you.
is wait. As we wait on him, he waits on us. God's just keeping reminding me of his faithfulness and his love. And how he comes to find us. You know, oftentimes we're consumed with trying to find him. And yet he's standing right there. He comes to meet us right where we're at. We don't have to dress up, pretend to be anything other than what we are right now, in this moment. He comes to find us and meet us where we're at. His faithfulness and his love endures beyond anything that we could imagine. His love endures. I'm just going to invite David up to come and lead us in communion this morning to remind us of his love.
I just want to share a wonderful aspect of God. When I became a Christian, you go through that awesome time with God, the wonder of it, you know. I came to the Lord when I was 27, and I can tell you, at 27 years old, when I realized I'd come to salvation, I was walking down the street, and I stopped walking, and I started skipping down the street. 27-year-old skipping. I was just so overwhelmed by the goodness of God to me. I skipped with joy. And God just did crazy things, you know. I just said to God, I want to walk on water, and I'm prepared to get wet, God. I'm prepared to get wet, God. It's just me and you, you know. No one else is going to get hurt, you know. If I look a fool, I'm going to look a fool. If I get it wrong, I'm going to get it wrong. And I, just bear with me because this is going somewhere. And I had two jobs. in 10 years. And then we went through the recession that we had to have, and I had 10 jobs in 2 years. And God just did crazy stuff. You know, because with the recession, the last guy on was the first guy off. So I just kept losing my job. And God just kept providing jobs. And crazy stuff, like I'd have a guy ring me up and say, do you want a job? And I'd be just sitting overwhelmed by God. No one's done that. How awesome are you? And so I came to this situation where I had this, I needed a job, and I said, God, I need a job. And I flicked through the paper, and God just spoke to me and said, that's your job. I only want you to apply for that job and that job only. And of course I got it. I had to go through a 4 hours of aptitude tests. So, you know, God, it was a God setup. And so I learned a valuable lesson. And I had this privilege of working with this man who was an absolute genius. He did his PhD in 18 months. It takes 3 years. 18 months, finished. His university guy that was over the top wouldn't accept his PhD. He said, this is no way. It's absolutely no way somebody can finish their PhD in 18 months. And of course, you know, he did. And so I got an aspect of God. This guy was an absolute genius. I was a privilege to work with him. He blew me away, just constantly blew me away. He was just such an incredible man. And it opened my eyes to an aspect of God. God is a genius. Absolute genius. The Word of God. When you get a revelation of that, you approach God completely differently. You read the Bible completely differently. He's a genius. Absolute genius. And so I want to talk about an aspect of God. His Word is amazing. Now the Bible talks about Jesus hung on a tree. I got scriptures here, but I'm just going to flow. You know, and in Deuteronomy it says, you know, anybody that's hung on a tree is cursed by God. Right? So in that aspect, Jesus became the curse for us. He took it all. You know, amazing. And then Jesus sets up a new covenant and he says, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Because my body is food indeed and my blood is drink indeed. Interesting, isn't it? And God took me back to, there's a tree in the garden. Called the tree of life, because that was the heart of the Father and that's the heart of the Son. So, and Paul talks about this in Corinthians, about Jesus hanging on a tree. And so if I'm drinking the blood of Jesus and I'm eating body of Jesus, as we're about to do, and he hung on a tree, and there was a tree in the garden that was called the tree of life. I want to leave you with this thought: are we eating from the tree of life again because of Jesus? Because he hung on a tree, because his body is food indeed. His blood is food and drink indeed. Are we eating from the tree of life? Did Jesus re-establish the tree of life in our lives? Because he took the curse. So if he took the curse, then there is no curse. There is no curse. The Father's heart was to give us life and life to the full. So I want to leave you with that thought. When you come up and take the drop cup and take the blood, I want you to think tree of life, that you will live forever. No separation between God and you. Do you need life today? Do you need God's life in a situation? I want you to come up now and take the cup, and I want you to go back and think about that. I know where I stand on it. I know where I stand on it. I know where I stand on it. See, this cup is symbolic, but it is so, so much more. There's so much to this cup. There's so much to this bread, this body of Christ. See, Jesus said in John, the devil comes to kill, rob, and destroy. How does Jesus destroy the works of the devil? He says, I have come to give you life. Not just any old life, abundant life. When the devil rocks up, when the devil tries to kill and destroy, Jesus counters it with, I'm going to give them even more life. As we take this cup, my prayer for you is that you eat from the tree of life and that God blesses you with abundant life, because that is the heart of the Father. Abundant life, abundant relationship with the Father, abundant relationship with Jesus, abundant relationship with the Holy Spirit, abundant relationship with your children, with your wife, your family, your friends, your work colleagues. Right? I love that song up here, you know. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That makes the truth a person. That makes life a person. All right? That makes the truth a person. It's not a truth, it's the truth. The truth is living. Living truth. You shall not die, it shall not fade, it shall never pass away. Why don't you stand with me as we take and eat of Jesus and celebrate the wonder that he has done in our lives. Let's eat together. Let's drink together. Bless you guys. Be really blessed.
Thanks. Wow. Well, why don't you go turn around and greet someone? Find someone you don't know. Find someone you haven't seen for a while and give them a big hug and a kiss. All right, why don't we come back to our seats? It's great to be here this morning, and we've got plenty of time after the service for more fellowship. So why don't we come back to our seats, and well, it's great to be back. Gary and I actually went away for the first time in a long time for just family. There was no church and no work and no, it was a great 4 days. We got to see my brother and his wife, whom we haven't seen for over 2 years. So we're back in New Zealand, so might have a bit of a weird accent back. Nah, oh sweet. They kept complaining that I sounded Aussie. I was like, awesome. It was like, I wasn't doing my cheese brew, you know. Nah, it was a really good time, and so we just, but we missed you, but we got to see an amazing speaker last week. If you missed it, it's on the podcast and our live stream recorded, so you can find it, but please see last week. It was a great message, so I'm just going to get straight to notices. How many of you are already registered for Jamie Galloway weekend? Come on. For those who have missed out the early bird, you missed out the early bird. The early bird finished just this last week. But you can still register. It's the 21st through 23rd of July. For those who have no idea who Jamie Galloway is, he is a prophet. And so it's going to be really fun to have a prophet come to town and really just share what the Lord's been doing around the world and also share what he believes is happening in your life. You know, it's always really good to hear prophets come to town. Our Sri Lankan team, missions team, are going in like 3 weeks, I think. 2 weeks. They're leaving in 2 weeks' time. So the 18th of June and the 25th of June, so the next two Sundays, are going to be an offering time. We're going to take up special offering for the Sri Lankan team. We will also introduce you to who's going and get to pray for them and send them with the love of the family. We also have a presbytery coming up. Sam, when's the presbytery? The 18th. Oh, that's next week, is it? Yes. We have so our students, once a month now, are going to be doing prophetic presbytery. So that is before the service. If we don't announce it, then it'll be during. Once we get them a little bit further down the track, they will do it from the front during the service. But we're being nice to our students at the moment, and they're going to be breaking up into groups of two or three, and it will be between 9:05 and 9:45 in that room there. So come early if you want a prophetic word, and it's different students every time. We also have seniors coming up on Wednesday. So see Peter and Aileen Stokes for any details that you need. Last but not least, we have a meeting on Tuesday night here at 7:30 for a 7:45 start. We're bribing you with a really yummy dessert. So if you call Hillview your home, you want to be there on Tuesday night at 7:30 for a 7:45 start. Don't miss it. Please bring your kids if you can. And be here as a family. So I think that's it for the notices. I would love to, I remember. Any wedding anniversaries or birthdays? Going once. That is a first in June. Usually like everybody's born in June. You're born in June, have you had one already? 19th, oh you could get it next week. You could double dip if you really want to. Come on. Come grab it. Keeps you going till lunch at least. I can't eat chocolate anymore. It's very sad. She's dairy free. Seriously, I did not realize how selfish I was until I became a mum. And then all of a sudden your whole world changes and it becomes all about them. It's all good. When I finish feeding her, I will go straight back to the chocolate. I promise you that. I get to take up tithes and offerings today. And I'm really just so encouraged by God's extravagance. And this morning, I want to exhort you. When you bring your tithes and offerings, you know, Jesus said to the disciples, give to God what is God's and give to Caesar what is Caesar's, right? And when that is like the baseline principle of how we should live our life with our finances. And when we actually give to God what's His, we get to entrust Him with something that is finite. And He translates it into something that is immeasurable. You see, God gave not half His Son. God didn't give a tenth of His Son. He gave the whole of His Son. But we only have to give back 10% or a tenth, whatever, however you want to skin that cat. We just, yeah, that's it. When we trust Him with what's His, it's all He's asking us for. When we trust Him with what's His, it unlocks, it's a spiritual principle, it unlocks the unlimitlessness of God in our lives. It unlocks His extravagant blessing. Because Malachi 3 says, I will open the windows of blessing so much so that you will not have room enough to contain it. His extravagant blessing is open and available for all of us. And when we come with our tithes and with our offerings before the Lord, we are saying, yes, I agree with your extravagant blessing. And you know what? Most of us don't believe we deserve it. Most of us believe we don't give enough, work enough, read enough, pray enough. But all He's asking is for our heart to be connected with His heart. And that we give so that He can pour out so much more. The one cool thing that I've learned is you can never outgive God. I dare you to try and watch what happens when you try and outgive God. His extravagance is open for us. She's looking at me. His extravagance is open for us. And so when we declare and pray over our tithes and offerings today as kings and priests, I want you to believe God for something that you think is impossible. I want you to believe that not only your paycheck is going to go further than it could have ever gone, but you'll also have leftovers. And that leftovers will increase to more leftovers. And that leftovers will increase to more leftovers. Because you see, even when He took up the 12 baskets after He'd multiplied the five loaves and two fish, there was so much left over that people couldn't eat it all. And that's the kind of abundant life that Jesus is talking about. Amen? How cute is she? Like, seriously. She'll be grabbing the microphone before I know it too. So why don't we get our tithes and offerings prepared? And if you give it electronically, I'd love you just to stand with me this morning. We're going to pray and declare over our tithes and offerings this morning. So why don't we stand? It's coming. All right, are we ready? All right, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for heaven opened, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created. Dreams and visions, angelic visitations, declarations, signs and wonders with divine manifestations. Anointing, gifting, and calls, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations. Souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revelation. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will pour out favor, blessings, and increase upon me so that I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven and see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Just going to pass this morning we have the great privilege of hearing Gary Morgan when he's ready to come up. So I want to welcome.
Thank you. Wow. Why don't we stand a minute and just open our hands and open our hearts. The Bible says in John chapter 1, it says, for as many has received him, He gave them the power to be the children of God. That's not just inheritance. That is an atmosphere. That is a reality. He says power to inherit. And so we don't just receive inheritance. We receive a power. And so for as many as received him. And so I don't want to talk this morning about, you know, what it is to receive or how to receive. But I want to bless our receivers this morning. The reason I can receive a call is because I have a device that is connected to a network. Your heart is a device. Your heart is a part of you that is a receiver of the things of God. And so for us to recognize that we have a call in God is also to recognize that we have a heart to receive. And so for me, it's open hearts and open hands that align us to a place of allowing that which God wants to pour out to be poured out. Amen? And so I don't want this to be a normal meeting. I don't want this meeting to be hey, let's just listen to Gary speak. I want to activate something here this morning. I want to allow something to activate and be realized in this place, that our spiritual senses get awakened here in this place. Amen? That we don't just become a people who are dull to the things of God. The Bible talked about a church that was dull of hearing or dull of senses, and I don't want to be that person. I don't want to be a person that's dull to the things of the Spirit, but I want to be acutely aware that as he moves, as he speaks, as he manifests, that I become aware of that. Amen? And so I want us right now, the Bible says, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. It's not out of what's in the heart the mouth speaks. It says out of the overflow. That means there's something that's being filled. It means that our heart is filled, and out of the overflow of what it's filled with, our mouth speaks. And so you might find yourself in a position where you're like, well, Gary, I'm just struggling to praise. I'm struggling to pray. I'm struggling to believe. Can I suggest to us this morning that might be the reason is because our heart isn't filled, our heart is empty. And so first we have to ask the Lord to fill. And once something is filled, that's when it begins to overflow. The Christian life begins to have manifestations is when it comes from that overflow place, not just that filled place. And so my prayer every day isn't that God would fill me, but that he would overflow me. Because when the overflow happens, that's when people start getting blessed. I get blessed when God fills me. Other people get blessed when that begins to overflow. So what does it look like to live an overflowed life? And so my prayer here today is that something activates, that we don't just get informed today, but we get transformed with revelation that allows us to become people of the Spirit and not just people who are dull of hearing. Amen? Am I talking to someone, say? And so I want us right now just to posture our hearts. You see, to know our heart, we got to get connected to our hearts. And so I want us right now just to close your eyes. The reason I'm asking you to do that is so that you don't get distracted. But just close your eyes right now. And I want to teach you. I want to teach you the entrance or the activation of the Spirit. Because I want you right now to think of the last time. Think of a memory. The last time you were absolutely so lost in God that you felt so close to God and you felt God so close to you. I want you to think of that time right now. Just think of that moment. This is what we call Emmanuel moments, God with us. And this place, this memory becomes an activation for you to step into the Spirit. And so just think of that moment right now. And allow that atmosphere to begin to manifest around you. As you begin to feel, experience, meditate, bring to memory. That's why God asked the children of Israel to remember, bring back to memory what I've done. Because it brought them into the reality of what he had done and the revelation of what he could do. So we're going to just take a moment right now, 30 seconds, just to remember that place, that Emmanuel place with God. This is the weapon of our warfare. This ability to remember. That's why all throughout the Old Testament, that's why Jesus said when he came to the table, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. The word remember literally means to grow again or to realize. It's like if an arm was cut off, to remember it is to put it back. And a lot of times we forget the victory because we're too busy being the victim. Let me say that again. Too many times we forget the victory because we're too busy being the victim. And so I want us to take our seats now if we can and stay in that place. Because this is how the Lord begins to work in our hearts. This is how the Lord begins to cause a fullness to begin to manifest. That we're not just a people who are tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, and we don't find ourselves being affected, but we begin to be effective in what God wants to do. Am I talking to somebody? Hello. Yeah? And so I want to talk to us today. I want to equip us today with life in the Spirit. Because we've been in this season of the impossible. And one of the things that people talk to me a lot of times is Gary, I struggle with maintaining my life in the Spirit. I struggle with not being so carnally minded that I become spiritually minded. I struggle with all the news that's coming at me, with all the events that's happening in the world. I struggle to stay spiritually minded. I find myself getting so carnal every day. And so I want to give us some keys this morning, if I can, to equip us into a lifestyle where we begin to allow the Lord tools, if you must, tools that allow us to stay in the Spirit. Am I talking to somebody? Now, this doesn't mean you become balloons, and this doesn't mean you become astronauts, and you're so heavenly minded for earthly good. But sometimes we can be so earthly minded to be heavenly good as well. And so God wants to give us balances today, yeah? And so if you've got your Bible, I want you to turn with me to Romans chapter 8. And we're going to begin in verse 14. Actually, let's begin in verse 12. This is what Paul says. I'm reading from the NSAB. He says, "So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, or if you are living according to the flesh, you must die." Wow. If you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Verse 14, "For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading again to fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him." I want us to look at something new. You know, one of the detriments of, I believe, of Christianity is we have this stinking thinking that if we do this, it qualifies us for that. And that is not the gospel. Jesus did what Jesus did to make us qualified already. And there's no action that we can do. There's no requirement that we need to fulfill, because requirement is of the law. Relationship is of love. And the biggest detriment comes is when we believe that again, for us to be led by the Spirit, we first have to be sons. It doesn't say that. It says, "For as many are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God." It's not being led by the Spirit. It's not the action that qualifies us. It's actually the inheritance that activates the being led of by the Spirit. And so it's the action, not the approval. This is what we believe. We will be approved to be led by the Spirit if we recognize our sonship. It doesn't say that. What activates us being led by the Spirit is that we are sons. You see, Tobias listens to me. Why? Because he is my son. If someone else comes into the house who he doesn't know and says to him, hey, go and do this, you want to see his face when they try and do that. Yeah, right. But he's led by me. He listens to me. Why? Because there's relationship there. And this is the beautiful invitation we have as sons and daughters of the Most High, is that our activation, the place of sonship, activates us being led by the Spirit. Now, this is what it goes on and says, and I want to bring this out of Romans. I love Romans. If you want to get an understanding of Romans, then begin to understand Romans 6, 7, and 8, because you bring that together and something powerful happens. This is what it says. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again. You see, to be led, we feel like it's a militant thing, or it's a control thing. You see, we're not led out of control. We're led out of God's compassion for us. And one of the things we begin to understand, and one of the things, hey, buddy, I love you. One of the things we begin to understand is as we're led by the Spirit, so we come into a place of realizing that God doesn't lead us out of control. He leads us out of love. That's why Paul qualifies in the next statement. Listen, guys, this isn't something that's going to lead again to slavery, but this is something that's activated by sonship. And you see, when God begins to use the word command, when God begins to use the word lead, when God begins to use certain words in a new covenant context, our minds continually go back to slavery instead of sonship. So when we hear the word command, how many people believe that's a militant term? How many people believe that that's a law term? Because why? It's called the Ten Commandments. And so the Ten Commandments to the new believer or to the new creation isn't got nothing to do with a command that leads to law. It's a command in love. It's an invitation, not an instruction. And this is what I love about God. He leads us into places of instruction, of invitation, not into the place of instruction. Yeah? Is that right, buddy? I love you. And so I want us this morning to recognize something. Let's go on and read this. This is what it says. But you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit. I want us to look at something here. Everyone say the word testimony. Everyone say the word testimony. What is testimony? Testimony is evidence or an account of something that is true. The Spirit testifies with our spirit. What does that do? The Spirit is saying to us, this is who you are. This is my account of you. This is the evidence I have. You see, a testimony is given in this area. When someone needs to produce evidence for a conviction, they give a what? I've done something really bad. Adam witnessed it. In a court of law, he will be asked to give his testimony. You see, in the area of sin, a testimony convicts us to judgment. In the area of sonship, it convicts us to righteousness. In the area of sin, a testimony will convict you to judgment. In the area of sonship, testimony convicts you to righteousness. That's why he wants us to have a revelation of our sonship. So when he comes and the Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God, what he's doing is the Spirit is giving continual evidence of who we are. Therefore, that convicts us to righteousness. Is it going off for someone? It convicts us to righteousness. It tests us. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit. With our spirit. Continually giving an account of who we really are. And this is what I love about God. Sometimes he lets us in on them testimonies. And this is my prayer before him is, Lord, I want to hear the testimony. And this is what I love about Revelation 19:10. It says that the spirit of prophecy, or the testimony of Jesus, is the what? Spirit of prophecy. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit, or the activation of. Now, some of you are like, yeah, that's a great verse. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. To truly understand, let me use Tweedledee and Tweedledum here. Come here, guys. Just stand right there. David can be Jesus today. Well done. Warren can be Warren. This is how the testimony of Jesus becomes the spirit of prophecy. You see, when a prophet or someone with prophetic gifting we prophesy, when we prophetically encourage someone, the spirit of prophecy activates when we tune our ears to the testimony of Jesus about that person. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When I begin to listen to the testimony of Jesus, the testimony of Warren according to Jesus. Jesus, what do you say about this person? And as I begin to release through the spirit of prophecy, I am activating the testimony of Jesus on their life. Therefore, they become convicted to righteousness. That's why Corinthians says that they will come in and hear you prophesy, and they will fall down and give their lives to God. Why? Because they're coming in to the testimony of Jesus about them. Am I speaking to somebody? They come in and they listen to the testimony. You see, the world's telling them one thing, but Jesus is telling them another. Give it up for these guys. The testimony of Jesus. The Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. Not were, not going to be, but are. Fully present, fully realized. And so I want to say to you right now, is a lot of us in this place, if not most of us, need to come in and receive the testimony of the Spirit, the testimony of Jesus, and the testimony of the Father about us. Well, Gary, you told us that the testimony of the Spirit allows us to be the children of God, yes. And the testimony of Jesus according to Revelation is the spirit of prophecy. But what's the testimony of the Father? Well, that's simple. Go to the baptism of Jesus. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. The testimony of the Father over you right now is that you are his beloved and that he is well pleased with you. I watched The Shack last night. It absolutely rocked my heart, because this is what I continually heard coming out of the Father. I am particularly fond. And Mac turns around and says, you're particularly fond of everyone. Why? Because we're all the children of God. And this is the beautiful thing, is that this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. If you want the testimony of Jesus, then recognize that it's the spirit of every prophetic word that you've ever received. If you want the testimony of the Spirit, then it is you are a child of God. And if you want the testimony of the Father, it is that you are beloved and he is well pleased with you. Wow. That is three testimonies. And this is what I love about God, is if we were in a courtroom right now, we have an accuser of the brethren standing right there saying all manner of ill against us. James tells us, count it all joy when you fall into various trials and people speak all manner of stuff against you. We have one in the corner there. But guess what? For the one that is accusing us, we have three that's testifying for us. We have three that are testifying. And they are speaking every prophetic word over our life. They're speaking out. We are children of the Most High. And they're speaking that we are beloved and well-pleased. Now, you can't get a better gospel than that. Amen? And so what does that look like? That looks like the revelation that we are the children of God, that we are born not just of the Spirit, we are born to live in the Spirit. And that is the testimony that is coming from the Godhead, that we are born not just of the Spirit, but we were born to live in the Spirit. John Wimber said that we are not earthly beings having a spiritual experience. We are spirit beings having an earthly experience. And this is the beautiful revelation that I believe most Christians trip up on, is because they're listening to the accuser instead of the activator of their faith. They're listening to the accuser instead of the author. You see, I am a book written by God. If He is the author of my faith, then I am a book. I am a masterpiece. I am a manuscript that is written by someone, and that someone is Jesus Christ. Therefore, if you want to know the story, don't listen to the critic, listen to the creator. If I want to find something out, I had the privilege when we were in Tahoe to actually sit down with the producer of The Shack, Brad Cummings. And I just had this moment with him of understanding the real heart behind the movie. And I could have listened to the critics. I could have listened to everyone, oh yes, this is that. But when you sit down with the creator, you begin to understand the essence of everything that is to take place, everything that is in, the behind the scenes stuff that I didn't know unless I talked to him. If you want to know the behind-scenes stuff of your life, don't listen to the accuser. We need to get to the author. Yeah? And so God is bringing us into this place of beginning to recognize that we have a testimony over our life. And the testimony that's over our life is not man-inspired. It's God-breathed. And this is what I love every day, that we get to step into, that we get to live out, that we get to be the reality, that we get to be the expression of that testimony. That my life is the testimony of that which the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is speaking. And the accuser of the brethren can say what he wants, because there is a word that is greater. There is a word that is final. There is a word that never stops. Am I speaking to somebody? Now, one of the things that we struggle with as believers is I'll call it separation anxiety. The same with a child. You see, when I get up and go and leave the room, Tobias straight away is like, Dad, where are you going? Where are you going? But you know, one of the things I've realized, that sometimes if I'm going to leave the room and do something, I'll leave him my phone, or I'll leave him my wallet, or I'll leave him something. So he's got something to hold on to, knowing Dad's going to come back for that. There's no way Dad's going to leave and not come back for that. And so if I leave him with something, then he's fine. And this is what I love about the Lord. This is what Jesus said: I'm going, but I'm going to give you someone. I'm going, but I'm going to give you some. The comforter is not called the comforter because he's a blanket or a doona. The comforter is called the comforter because sometimes life gets uncomfortable. Sometimes situations happen. Sometimes the proverbial hits the fan. That's why we have the comforter. But he's left us with someone. Now, we can go one step further than that. I love what David said today about the way, the truth, and the life, not just being a saying, but a person. You see, this is what I love. Jesus, when he spoke, didn't just speak words. He spoke substance. So when I don't feel him, I still have his truth to hold on to. You see, his truth is still present in my life. When I don't feel him, when I feel distant, and it's not because God's got anywhere, it's probably because my heart has. You see, in the garden, God didn't distance himself. Adam and Eve did. Yeah? How am I speaking to somebody? And so in that moment, we have to realize that when we feel that distance, we have truth to hold on to. We have life that we can continue living, and we have a way that he's given us. Yeah? This is what tunnels to GPS are a pain in the backside. But this is, I love Google. This is what Google does. Google looks at where you're going, and if there's tunnels, it'll automatically download that way or tunnel into the phone so that when you go out of reception, you've still got the way. It's flipping genius, man. And this is what God does. God recognizes there are sometimes valleys of the shadow of death that happen in our lives. But he's already downloaded to us the word. And this is what it says in 3 John. It says, don't be afraid, little children, because you've already got the word. You've already overcome because of the word that's in you. Not because of the word that I'm here with you. It's because of the word you've already got. You've overcome. And so life in the Spirit has to come to a place where we realize that God is bringing us to this testimony. And this testimony is we get to cry, Abba, Father. And I love the word Abba, Father. You see, the word Abba comes from this place. And I believe, and many scholars have said, it was the first word that Adam spoke when God awakened him, which was a breath. It's like, but that speaks of a child. That speaks of Emma. That speaks of Tobias. Abba is a child in the Hebrew, in the Greek. It's a child expression. But Father speaks about matured sonship. And this is the beautiful thing of God, is he leads us into this place in the Spirit that again, we have this Greek thinking that I have to mature out of Abba and I have to now recognize him as Father. And again, I loved it in the shack. You know, one minute, you know, it's a black woman, and the next minute, it's an American Indian man. It's like, wow. And why? Because of what Mac needed in that moment. And this is the beautiful thing that we have to realize as Christians, is maturity doesn't mean that you don't need Abba anymore. You see, again, it's in our life. You know, I've become 18. I'm a man. I don't need my dad. There are times in my life when I've cried for the presence of my father. That he's all the way in Wales, and there's times when I'm like, oh, I wish my dad was here to share this moment. Or there's times when I find myself in a dark night of the soul, where I just want my dad. You know, there's times when I got man flu, I just want my mom. I tell you, it's worse than the bubonic plague. When you get man flu, you know, you just want your mom. You just want that hug. You just want that embrace. My mom died in 2011. But there's times, and you see, it's the same in God. This is what happens, and this is what religion does. Religion says, you've now become mature, you can't go back. God is both Abba and he is both Father. And there's times when he's a father and there's times when he's an Abba. And this is what we have to embrace in the Christian life. This is what we have to embrace in life in the Spirit. There's times when we cry Abba and there's times when we cry Father. And God is inviting us into this reality that we're not so proud and we're not so mature that we can't cry on his shoulder. But there's also times when we get childish instead of childlike, and the father shows up and says, listen, son, grow up. Suck it up, princess. Because though, you know, morning lasts for a night, joy's going to come in the morning. So you need to realize who you are, and where you're going. And there's times, how many people have felt, and I'm going to use two words which seem opposite to each other, the gentle rebuke of the Lord. I call God the smiling assassin, because it's like he can rebuke you with the most love. It's like you feel absolutely, oh my gosh, I'm so convicted right now, but why is God smiling? Why do I feel so much love right now, but yet I feel so convicted? And this is what I love, not condemned. You see, anger condemns, joy convicts. And this is what we do with Tobias. You know, it's like, oh, buddy, you know, you're not going to have any milk. That's a bummer, dude. Sorry. And he's like looking like, am I going to get, yeah, it's your choice. We said if you did that, this is the consequence. So you're free to choose, but you're not free from the consequences of your choices. Bummer. And so, you know, it's like, what's happening here? You know, I thought the wrath of my dad was going to come down on me. No, no. It's you've just chosen. Yeah? And that's what God does with us. Amen? Am I speaking to somebody? And so, life in the Spirit, and this is what I love, is when you begin to step into the revelation and the reality that a lot of us are still living in this space of not feeling qualified, of not feeling called, of not feeling approved. We feel accused, but we don't feel approved. We feel distant, but we don't feel drawn. And this is what the Lord is inviting us into. And I want to give us two keys right now of what I believe is communion and intimacy with the Lord. And this is why I believe God wants to activate something right now. This is what the Lord said to me this morning. He said, Gary, I'm gonna activate dreams. I'm going to activate spiritual senses. There's going to be something opened up in the people today that's going to allow them to live in the Spirit. And I'm believing right now, by the end of this time, that through what I've shared will awaken and activate something within us. Because I believe there's people here right now, your dream life has been stunted. Your dream life has been capped. Your dream life has been shut down. Well, God wants to unlock and open some things up. That are our walking in the Spirit. I tell you, there's at least two people here right now that you lived, you walked, you breathed in the Spirit, but because of the opinions of man and the control of religion, something has shut down in you. Well, I want to say to you right now, it's going to open up. It's going to open up. The shackles and the yoke of slavery are coming off. Because I believe God wants us to be people of the Spirit that live in the Spirit, that walk by the Spirit and walk with the Spirit. Amen? Am I talking to somebody? And so I want to talk to you right now about this. You see, this is one of the things we teach in the school. The key to your next encounter is found in your last. And one of the things I want to teach you right now is to find what I call your door. What is your door to the Spirit? What is your door? And why I use the word door is because we find in the book of Revelation, there seems to be a theme. And this is one of the things that is so key in life in the Spirit, is to find the theme, find the door, find the one thing that seems to be the absolute throughout your walk in the Spirit. For John in Revelation, it was a door. So we find that. Find it in John 2, John 3, John 4. He said, behold, I see a door standing open. Then in John chapter 3, it's like, behold, Jesus is standing at the door knocking. Then in Revelation 4, it's like, whoa, behold, I see a door open again. And so the door seems to be the key. And so when you find life in the Spirit, it's finding what is the trigger, what is the catalyst, what is the key in ignition that's going to open up life in the Spirit for you. So for me, it's a tree or a path of foliage that the Lord always takes me down. Straight away, and sometimes I hear the Lord say, let's go for a walk. And when I hear that, when I feel that, I know I'm about to go into something. And so for me, in my imagination, and remember your imagination is the seedbed for revelation. Now, as a good evangelical, I always said, well, Paul warns against vain imaginations. One thing we have to realize, he warned against vain imaginations. He didn't speak against sanctified imaginations. Yeah? And so for me, it's that vision. It's that place. Now, the question you've got to ask yourself, what is it for you? It could be a worship song. It could be a prayer. It could be a vision. You see, John in Revelation 3 saw a door. It didn't turn into a tractor in Revelation 4. Or it didn't turn into a, you know, a fairground or something else. There was a theme, and this is one of the things I like to say. Find the theme in your dream. And when you find it, you have access. Am I speaking to somebody? And so what's the trigger for you? What's that place? What's that Emmanuel moment that's going to bring you into the Spirit? You see, a friend of mine, it's Psalm 23. He just begins to recite Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Poof, all of a sudden, he finds himself in the Spirit. Exactly. And so this is one of the things I want to teach us today. And it comes out of Revelation 3:20, and it comes out of Revelation 4:1. You see, one of the things that we believe as Christians is that we have to be the ones that step in the Spirit. That we have to be the ones, like we worship and the Lord takes us in. We have to pray and the Lord answers. We have to speak and the Lord shows up. And so we have, again, this stinking thinking that we have to, God does. But what does it look like? You see, most of us, let me ask this question. Most of us are praying to step into the Spirit, but what does it look like for the Spirit to step into us? You see, again, pictorially, we have this expression that I'm stepping into the Spirit. What does it look like for the Spirit to step into us? Well, Gary, I need scripture and a verse for that. Well, you got it right now. Revelation 3:20. Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man opens the door, I will step into him and dine with him." There's a key there. It's all about food. "I will dine with him and he with me." You see, Revelation 3:20 is about Jesus stepping into us. You know, we've used it. I used to use it on open air. When I was saved as a Baptist, used to go out on open air and you know, on the street corner with the big, you know, speakers. Testing, 1, 2, 1. Oh, that's right. Now let's bring the wrath of hell upon this community. Turn or burn. You know, and I'm like, what? You know, the good news became the depressed news. And so, you know, we used to use verses. And how many people have used these verses in open airs or witnessing? Revelation 3:20, Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart. That's got nothing to do with the unsaved. That's to do with the church. And so for me, it's this place of, this is where we become aware. This is where we become open. This is where we get to listen to the testimony of Jesus, and this is the action of his testimony, that he is knocking on the door. But I love Revelation 3:20, because this is what it says. "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine or sup or have supper or a feast or whatever with him and he with me." You see, it's not about the knock. It's about the voice. And this is what's happened for so long, is we've been opening the doors to knocks instead of opening doors to the voice. And sometimes the hard knocks of life are knocking and we're opening the door. And we wonder why we go through hell sometimes. Why? Because we're opening the door to knocks instead of opening its doors to his voice. Am I speaking to somebody? You see, when I used to go visit my grandmother, this is what I find funny about Australia. It's not like the UK. In the UK, we have letterboxes in the door. How many palms here? Come on. Letterbox in the door. You don't have it at the front of the, you know, like these days. It's in the door. So literally, you used to knock the door and then you used to open the letterbox and go, "Grandma," or "Mammo." "Mammo, it's Gary." Ah, and she used to come and open the door. But if someone knocked the door, she used to shout, "Who is it?" And they used to say, go bugger off, go away. And she had the power of who she opened the door to, who not. Why? Because of the voice. And this is a key for us, church, is What are we opening the door to? Are we opening the door to this? Or are we opening the door to, you are my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased? Ah, Father, it's you. Open the door. You see, Jesus wants to step into us. And the way Jesus steps into us and steps into every situation is when we begin to listen to his voice. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. When we begin to hear his testimony, when we begin to hear his view, when we begin to hear his opinion on the matter, that's when he steps in. Revelation 3:20. But again, guys, it's not just about Jesus stepping into us. Sometimes he wants us to step into him. Revelation 4:1. Behold, I saw a door open. Where? In heaven. And a voice spoke with me. And so I heard a sound like a trumpet speaking with me. Come up here and I'll show you what must take place after this. You see, we've got to understand something. In the next verse, this is what John says. Immediately I was what? In the Spirit. Well, if he was in the Spirit in verse 2, where was he in verse 1? Certainly wasn't in Starbucks. Where was he? He was in that place of what I call sanctified imagination. He turned and he saw. Something opened up for him that allowed him to step in. And this is what I love. It says, I saw a door stand open in heaven and heard a sound as of a trumpet speaking with me. You see, what he heard was a trumpet, what he released. Speaking with, that word speaking with doesn't mean communicating. It means speaking with. It means speaking at the same time. That's what prophetic ministry is. That's what prophecy is when we speak with God. Yeah? Spoke with me. Come up here and I'll show you what must take place after this. In heaven, it sounded like a trumpet. On earth, it was words. Come up here and I'll show you what must take place after this. And John said, immediately I was in the Spirit. Two keys we've got to understand from this. One is sometimes there's a gentle voice that comes and is knocking. It's not the knock of his hand. It's the knock of his voice. I want to tell you, friend, he's drawing you every day, every waking moment, the moment that you wake up, the moment you go to sleep, in your dreams, in your wake time. Heaven is drawing you into encounter. Heaven is drawing you. Heaven is inviting you because heaven wants to step in. And this is what we have to learn. We have to learn. We have to become aware of. We have to have the realization that heaven is wanting to get our attention every day. That God doesn't have an off day. Wednesday is not God's off day. Friday is not God's off day. Sunday is not God's off day. Every day, heaven is wanting to say. Heaven is wanting to demonstrate. Heaven is wanting to testify. But there's times as well where we get not just the voice, we get the vision. I want to tell you, life in the Spirit is about eyes wide open. Turn to your neighbor and say, eyes wide open. Eyes wide open. Eyes wide open. When you begin to see situations, when you begin to see opportunities, when you begin to see them things where you like, God, I'm going to step in. I'm going to step in because this is a spiritual moment right here. And you step in all of a sudden. You see, I've determined that if I do anything mundane, I want to turn it into the miraculous. So when I pour in fuel into my lawnmower, I'm like, okay, Jesus, you and me for the next 45 minutes. And I take that lawnmower and I'm like, I'm in the Spirit. And I get downloads. Another place, sorry for the visual, is the shower. Shower for me is a mundane thing. But I turn it into a miraculous opportunity of, Lord, I'm stepping in. And I literally, as that door opens, I'm like, okay, look, behold, before me, I see a door standing open. Ha, Revelation says, I'll step in and you're going to show me what's going to take place after this. I want to encourage you, try it. Next time you take a shower, open that door and say, Lord, I'm stepping in. I'll tell you, some profound things will take place. And if you're a bath kind of person, well, you can baptize yourself every time. But I want to just put your head under, come up and just listen for that. Oh, there's my beloved son who seems to be well cleaned. And so I want to encourage you, turn moments into movements of his spirit. You see, when I go to, how I learned to walk in faith was I went to, you know, these Westfields and these automatic doors. I remember these automatic doors just came out. And I'm like, I remember going through one that, and you walk up and all of a sudden, poof, it opens up and you walk straight through. And I remember the first time that happened and the Holy Spirit whispered to me and said, Gary, this is what faith is like. This is what favor is like. This is what life in the Spirit is like. That I can open a door for you at any point and in any moment. And so I used to go to these places and I used to just walk up and say, thank you, Jesus. It opens up. And then I used to do and Tobias still to this day is like, that's right, son, you stick with me. This is how we do it. Except for one day I was caught off guard because I didn't realize Westfield opened at 10 o'clock instead of 9 o'clock. And so then I am walking up to the door and like smack, straight into my face. It's like, and you just feel the Lord going, that's right, son, just stick with me. But these are moments, these are times within our life that we get to turn into moments in God. How many of us bless our sleep time? How many of us bless our pillows? How many people bless our bed? How many people invite the angelic into our dream life? How many of us invite heaven into our moments? Or do you just go, oh, I wish I got a night's sleep tonight? You see, you can take melatonin or you can invite the Messiah. How many of us actually invite heaven into the mundane so that it becomes the miraculous? See, nothing should ever be mundane in our lives when it comes to walking in the Spirit. I call them opportunities that become moments and movements of His Spirit in my life. And so there's times, Revelation 3:20, where heaven wants to step into us. And there's times of Revelation 4:1, where we get to step into heavenly things. And so I want to pray for us right now. Jess, can you come and play some... Everyone's like, oh, who's this? Adam and Jess are a new part of our community. They're actually part of School of Prophets as well. And so let's welcome these guys. I love these guys. E, if you can play an E. It was transpose, so let's take transpose off. Because you'd be playing E flat. And I don't want any flat things in the Spirit, amen? And so, I want us, if we can, to stand right now. Wow. Thank you, Lord. And my prayer right now is that God would activate, that we would become aware of, that we would become people who recognize that we don't just get to step into heavenly things, but heavenly things get to step into us. That we get to hear the testimony of the Spirit, the testimony of the Son, and the testimony of the Father. Wow. That the testimony of Jesus is the Spirit of prophecy. That the testimony of the Spirit is that we are the children of God. And we are led as such. And the testimony of the Father is that we are His beloved and He is so pleased with us. You see, guys, the Christian walk though it has moments of pain is not painful. that he has never left us nor forsaken us. We don't approach him out of duty. We approach him, Bible says, boldly. That means with every constraint laid aside, boldly, with guts, boldly, without fear, approach the throne of grace where we obtain mercy in our time of need. So friend, whatever the fear has been, whatever the restraint has been, whatever the shackles have been today, whatever has inhibited you or disabled you, whatever has restricted you today from walking in the Spirit, my prayer is that God would unlock something so powerful right now in this place. That God would unlock. And I want to invite, I feel an impartation. If you're here right now and you've been struggling to walk in the Spirit, and you feel like you've been so caught up in the things of this world, you've been so caught up in distraction and them things that are so easily distracting us. Paul said, you know, I feel like the serpent deceived Eve. So our minds have been deceived or distracted from the simplicity that's in Christ. Friend, if you found yourself in that place, I want to pray for you right now. I'm going to invite you to come to the front. Just stand in front of me, and I want to pray for you right now. If you found yourself so restricted in the things of the Spirit, if you found yourself so held, I want to pray for you right now. It's not a time of you see, this is another thinking we have in Christendom. That this place down here is a place for issues. No, this is a place where we get to lay our lives again before him. This is where God does his business. There's no shame here. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Wow. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Just going to invite everyone to take a step forward if they can. There's more people coming. Friend, I'm going to ask you again, if this is you, if you resonated, if you felt what I shared today unlocked something, I want to invite you to come. I'm going to pray for you. If you're watching online, I want to invite you right now just to open up your heart. Allow the Lord to unlock. As we release the key of David here right now, Lord, to unlock that which needs to be locked. And Lord, unlock. We release the key of David. And Lord, we say, we unlock that which has been locked. In Jesus' name. I got given a gift back 10 years ago. And it was a prayer cloth that William Branham prayed over. I can't remember the last time I got this out. I'm going to get it out. Thank you, Jesus. And my prayer is that every shackle that the fear of man, every shackle that religion, every shackle that the carnality of this world has placed on you will break off, will break off, will break off. That you will be free. That you would be unbound. That you would be unrestricted. some of us need to get delivered of ourselves. God, that you would just take us and our wisdom out of the thinking, and you would bring your wisdom. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. As I come and just lay this, I'm just believing that God would just download and open up. And so just open your hearts and open your hands right now as we come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want everyone who's left in this seat, just begin to pray in the Spirit right now. Rakiana sondoro shiala kara sotoro bashiala karabayetas. Yenda kara siala mosombra babosubre kia. Rekinana masanda rabakiala sotoro shiala kara siataba. Remo mosombre kiana yendo sonda rakara sata rabakara. Rakana yenda basombra bakara satealos. Yedugo sore baboseta ramashiala nae. Nangora sonda rasatoroba. Reba basete remeando sonda. Rasa Tarama yende, remesinda rabosore abosoto karakara satarama, randa yendo songa rakio sotoroba, shatarama manzanda, renda seterebe, rando sombra comba rabadia sotora shia kialaba, rena nana kana nando sotoroba, yega rabasitara, reda da satarama sombra bosotoro shia la barbare, rememe yandaba, ramo sondoro shik. Manda sanda karasete randa sandamara. Wow. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Wow. Wow. Randa sanda rakiala baba. Jesus, we just unlock. We just unlock right now. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just unlock right now. Jesus' name. Wow. Release that impartation. We release it, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Release that impartation. Release that impartation. Thank you, Lord. Life in the Spirit is not a sprint, it's a marathon. Life in the Spirit is not about the event, it's about the encounter. And so, Father, right now in Jesus' name, Lord, I ask you to deposit such a reality in each and every person listening to the sound of my voice, that we would step into this truth, that we would step into this life, and that we would step into this way in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Just put your hand on the person next to you and say, Father, this is the your beloved in whom you're well pleased. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. If you're still receiving, then keep receiving. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Just keep receiving. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Bless you. Bless you, bless you, bless you. As you walk, you live, and you move in the Spirit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Bless you.